Hi everyone, and welcome to the sixth parallel session of the day. We have three sessions again during this time, and in the presentation hall one, we have curated paper sessions chaired by Dayashankar Maurya, assistant professor, graduate school of international relations, International University of Japan. In the presentation hall two, we have curated papers on COVID-19 response, chaired by Professor Ashwini Chhatre, Executive Director of the Bharti Institute of Public Policy. And here in the auditorium, we have a very interesting panel discussion on financial inclusion and technology policy and regulation. We have Mr. Chiragra Chakraborty, CEO, Katek Consulting Limited, as the moderator of this panel discussion. And along with him, we have the panelists, Mr. Arun Tavre, Certified Executive Coach, Katek Consulting, Mr. Ganesh Kumar Munarkot, Visiting Faculty, Kirith P. Mehta School of Law, Mr. Krishan Kumar Subramanian, Freelance Business Consultant, and Mr. Kshitij Prasad, AVP Research, Maybank Kim Engineering Securities India Limited. So welcome, Mr. Chiragra, and welcome panelists. We look forward to this very interesting discussion on financial inclusion, a thing that's been talked about very, very relevantly at this point of time. And linking it up to technology, regulation, and policy is what is required, from the perspective of India. Yeah, please, over to you.
Thank you, Arushi. Thank you a lot. Good afternoon, everyone. And I'm really happy to be back as a moderator of this panel discussion. Yesterday, we had a great session. So thanks to ISB and the other organizer for inviting us again for this. And definitely yesterday we had a live discussion, a lot of Q&As. Today also we'll have that. We have a expert panel here, so we'll be talking about that. But I would like to follow the pattern in this following manner, that I'll initially speak for around 5 to 7 minutes about financial inclusion, regulations and the risk. And from there, I would request other panelists to talk, share their viewpoint, and we can have a discussion among that. So to begin with, let me start the discussion by very, very basically defining financial inclusion. And I'm not going into any technical definition, but just I would like to share that what is financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is nothing but is a process to access financial assets or giving a financial assets, or you can say services, products related to finance to all the section of the people. So it covers from a grassroots level to the higher level. Everybody should get access to the financial products. That's basically in a nutshell what we are going to talk about. So basically, if I want to redefine it, I would like to say financial inclusion means credit to all, savings to all, investment for all, and at the same time is capital for all. That's also we should consider that. It's not only the saving and the credit part, but the capital for all. And that's why financial market also plays an important role in financial inclusion. So we'll talk about that in the course of time. But before I go to other part of my presentation, I would like to take a pause here and remember one gentleman whose name was Mr. K.C. Chakraborty. I think most of us know here, he was the ex-deputy governor of Reserve Bank of India and a veteran commercial banker who was part of Bank of Baroda and other public bank. Why I'm remembering him today is that he was pioneer in talking about financial inclusion in India. He spoke quite a bit. He was a policymaker for financial inclusion. And the reason why I'm sharing his name here is basically because we lost him yesterday. He died of heart attack. So rest him. So he has done a great job on financial inclusion. So discussing about financial inclusion without mentioning his name is not correct. So I just thought I should talk about him today. Now, Financial inclusion, when you talk about financial inclusion, there are two segments of financial inclusion. One part, if you talk about the economic growth, which is related to financial inclusion, and the second part, we talk about the convenience part of financial inclusion. So we'll try to divide this into two segments. And to do that, I would like to share some data with the panelist, which I would like to share here. Can you see? Yeah. So this is the data which I would like to share here. I have tried to take a few countries representing Asia and Africa. So I have India, Bangladesh, Kenya, Mauritius, South Africa, and Botswana. And the parameters which you have taken on the left hand side is basically the key financial inclusion parameters defined under IMF. And this data is from IMF. And we have taken it from 2015 to 2019 data. And if you see the parameters, we talk about ATMs per 100,000 adults. We talk about outstanding deposit with commercial banks as a percentage of GDP. We talk about outstanding loan of SME and MSME from commercial banks as a percentage of GDP. We are talking about outstanding loans overall from commercial banks as a percentage of GDP. And then we come to the number of registered mobile money accounts per 1,000 adults, value of mobile money transaction as percentage of GDP, and the value of mobile money transaction as percentage of GDP. Now, if I segment this table into two parts, I can share that outstanding deposit, outstanding loan on commercial banks, basically you're talking about from an economic growth perspective, but other parts are more from a convenience perspective for financial inclusion. So these are the two parameters which I was talking about. Now, if you see in this table, the ATMs per 100,000 adults, we have seen there's a growth in India, 6.7%. There's a growth in Bangladesh, but there's a fall in Kenya, Mauritius, South Africa, and there's again a growth in Botswana. Kenya, we know why it has gone down, basically because there are few banks which has closed down, and that's why the ATM cents has been removed, so the growth has gone down. South Africa also we can say, because people don't prefer to go to ATM because of various reasons, so the ATM's expenses, so they have gone down on that, but India has shown a growth there. So ATM is one thing which has got a mixed trend in different parts of the world. But outstanding deposit with commercial bank and the loan to SME and overall loan, if you see across the board, it has gone down. Whether it's India, Bangladesh, Kenya, Mauritius, South Africa, Botswana, there's a decline in the percentage growth. So that shows that the saving rate with commercial banks and loan taken from commercial banks are going down. But but there is a demand for investments and capital formation. So we are assuming that there are other sources from where the capital formations are being done. So maybe financial market, maybe non-banking entities. We'll talk about that. But that's one point I would like to highlight to the panelists, and they can talk about it when they are speaking about their point of view. But the best part of this table is the last three parameters: the number of registered mobile accounts per 1,000 adults, value of mobile money transaction as percentage of GDP, and value of mobile money transaction as percentage of GDP in 2019. And we see a drastic growth there. India has shown a drastic growth. Bangladesh also, Kenya, and so on and so forth. But the value of mobile money transaction as percentage of GDP also has gone up, but not so much in Kenya. Kenya, it is showing a decline. The reason is the Kenyan market has become very stagnant because it was already using M-Pesa and other things from long time back. So if you see the absolute term percentage of GDP in 2019, India has got 0.9%, Bangladesh has got 17.1%, but Kenya is 44.62%. So although there's a decline in terms of percentage, but an absolute percentage, they are pretty high using that mobile money transactions. So if you divide, and that's why you are saying that there's one part is the convenience part, the other part is the growth, economic growth part of financial inclusion, and we need to take care of both. Now, from there, taking a clue, and as I defined financial inclusion as a process, when you're talking about process, you need to nurture this process with investments, regulations, policies, so that this process become much efficient. The infrastructure, basic infrastructure for it. So we need investment in to develop this process. We need technology to develop this process. And if we don't regulate this properly, this may lead to huge amount of risk. So there is a risk element coming into this process of financial inclusion in a big way. And especially when you talk about technology, it makes the process efficient, but it has to be regulated very nicely so that the risk does not creep in. So when I talk about regulation, just one point I want to make it here, very important that, you know, when Basel came with Basel 1, Basel 2, and Basel 3, the major intention of Basel was to uniform the regulation, the uniformity of capital adequacy. Across the globe, whoever are the member of Basel committee, they need to have a basic capital adequacy, and above that, a local jurisdiction can take a call on that, but the minimum requirements is uniform. The point I'm trying to bring home is the uniformity of regulations, which is lacking in this case when you talk about financial inclusion. For example, if I talk here, let's say if I talk about cloud-based services. Now, if you read the regulations of Reserve Bank of India, if you read the regulation of Central Bank of Mauritius, South Africa Reserve Bank, or Kenyan Central Bank, the regulations are quite different. There's no uniformity in these regulations when you talk about cloud-based computing or cloud-based services. When you talk about data, the regulations are quite different. When you talk about cybersecurity, the regulations are quite different. So what I'm trying to bring home is that, and I would like to, you know, get panelists' view also on that, that uniformity of regulations should be there. Otherwise, the participants, the market participants, the banks, and so they can have a regulatory arbitrage. And which, because of that, that can lead to a risk. So one point is that we need to harp upon that all central banks and the Ministry of Finance should come together and they should have uniform regulations for financial inclusion so that the regulatory arbitrage does not take place. It is happening, and a lot of changes happened in 2020 because of COVID. All central banks are moving towards one direction of digitalization of bank process and the regulation, cybersecurity process and regulations, you know, data management process and regulations. So uniform, they are coming out with the regulations, but uniformity is required. So they should come together and make a more uniform regulations, like what we have for capital adequacy, what we have for accounting in IFRS 9. So same thing should be there from a financial inclusion perspective. So that's the first point I would like to make, that the uniformity of regulations is very important. Second point is I want to make, which is that will be the last point here, and then I'll stop, is since you're talking about financial inclusion, and we are seeing that the economic growth of financial inclusion is a major part of financial inclusion, and we need to have capital formations happening. I would like to take an example here, because we have seen that everywhere there are a lot of good potential projects comes which will require a lot of investments, and that investments, for example, any long-term project for financial inclusion comes, which requires huge amount of investments, and it's long-lasting. So it's basically like sustainable growth is required for those types of projects. And in that case, we will be definitely requiring that, if you see the data, around 3 to 4% funding comes from government agencies or IMF or World Bank. Remaining one, the market has to bring it. So either it is in terms of equity or it is in terms of bond has to be funded. Now, since these are projects are very long-term projects, equity investments comes in a minor funding, but more investments comes from the bond market side. And that's another area which you always look for, that from a financial inclusion perspective, the bond market should also be developed, and it should be developed in a better way. And there can, most of the, you know, technology can play a major role there also to develop this bond market or the equity market in a big way, which is also happening. The electronic based platforms are playing a major role so that it can take the financial market to one person's bedroom, and from there they can start trading and make more retail orientation can be brought into it. So the point here is the uniformity of regulations. The point here is the involvement of financial market in big way to do capital formations. And the third point is definitely to do all these things, we require huge amount of technology, which will be there, which will be absolutely required. So from that perspective, you know, I would like to stop at this go, but I'll come back again. But I would request Dr. Sitish Prasad, since he has been working with the banks for so long and has a banking experience. So I would appreciate that if Dr. Prasad can also talk about his view on financial inclusion part, and also talk about that how technology is helping in financial inclusion. And also, if you can speak from an economic growth perspective and capital formation perspective of financial inclusion. Dr. Prasad.
Good evening, good afternoon, everyone. I will just talk about how, particularly focusing more on India, how this is involved. Chirag has given a very broad definition of financial inclusion. What I am looking at financial inclusion is the unbanked households. We're talking about unbanked households that has it reached, you know. And one of the policy initiatives by the government was the Jan Dhan, the Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana, which was launched in 2014, you know, in which a lot of people who had no bank account, who had no access to ATMs, you know, how that has moved. Now, before I get into that, I would like to throw some light on the income pyramid of India. How it And this is based on research by National Council of Applied Economic Research, where if you categorize into four categories, that is rich, middle class, deprived, and aspirers, which means they are aspiring. So when deprived, the income level is less than 1,50,000 rupees, you know, annually. And a large chunk of the population, that is 684 million people. And if you look at the aspirers, there are 359 million people in that category. They have changed, this is a dated research, but just to give a thing, and the income range from 1,50,000 to 340,000 rupees. Rich, 16 million. So when we are talking about financial inclusion, it is these two segments, which is the large part, deprived and the aspirers, where we are looking at, and there's a huge income disparity. How do we do that? From that perspective, I looked at certain data of how the financial inclusions have happened. And according to some information which I gathered, the unbanked population is now 20% in India, 3% right now. It was earlier, it was around 50%. The internet penetration, when we talk about digitalization, it is 34% now. And 21% of the people, number of ATMs per 100,000 adults. Okay, these are data across countries. I'm not getting into it. Into Vietnam and all has a much larger unbanked area, almost 55%. And cash card transactions have increased to 32%. Cash transaction has come down. So obviously it is an influence on because of COVID and other aspects. In the last 7 years, see, there's a whole lot of digitalization. The volume has gone up in digital transactions from in INR, in rupees term, in last 2 years, from 20 billion, it has gone up to 31 billion. And the number of accounts has increased under the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana from 147 million in 2015 to almost 353 million as we speak now. So what I'm trying to highlight, why I gave you these examples, are that we are, in terms of unbanked, in terms of low income group, we are moving in the right direction, but there's a whole lot of work to be done, a whole lot of work. Because whether it's in terms of, as Chirag spread those data, in terms of depositing credit, it's a humongous task. But in India, if we look at the banking sector, you know, as I have discussed earlier on, that the commercial banks, because of their business size, they cater to a certain set of people, you know, which means in an organized banking, when I say that they will have a PAN, they will have a, they're filing income tax returns, they have a bank statement, they're salaried. What about people, say for example, in rural areas who runs a, say a small grocery store or who's a driver, how do we include those people? Okay? So there are dedicated smaller financial institutions who lends to them, which the number is going up. So even they want a housing loan, they want also to start a deposit. So apart from this, the opening of account because of other initiative by the government, we have insurance products, so other products also the poorer people are getting. So my contention from a banking perspective is more to do with it, how we bring the number of people in the mainstream, you know, like from a lower income group to middle income, and how we give them banking facilities in terms of products, services, insurance. That is what, that is my opening remark on this part. And sorry, to just add, Bangladesh is celebrating 50th year of their independence. They pioneered the concept of microfinance. And you just see that how the economic growth has happened. They are growing faster than Pakistan. They are almost there, you know, they're in all major economic parameters, life expectancy, they have really improved. They have a thriving garment.
Absolutely.
You know, so I'm trying to highlight here that each country, whether financial inclusion or anything, you have to have indigenous solutions for indigenous problems. It cannot be absolutely one thing speaking off. And that is what Bangladesh.
He did that. I think, Sridhar, you have touched the right pulse. You have made a very nice point, very nice point. And I think I have got a clue from that, which I want to take it up to Krishna Kumar. So I believe that since you said about Bangladesh and even India, I think we have real potential sitting in the urban, in the rural areas of India. Huge capital sitting there in the rural areas of India. How do we tap that? And I think that their technology plays a major role. That technology can take us to those places, nearest places through mobile and so on and so forth. So Krishna Kumar, I just wanted your view from that perspective, that how financial inclusion can, you know, really benefit from technology. And then definitely we'll also talk about the risk in the maybe next slide, but if you can start with your viewpoint from that perspective, Krishna.
Okay, thanks Chiragra. Okay, so am I audible? I mean,
yes.
Okay.
Yes, you are.
Yes.
Thank you. So basically, yeah, so technology, I think, especially in the last 1 year, we have suddenly realized that technology is playing a huge role in the financial services, in providing financial services. And one of the things I think that has become a buzzword now is digitalization. Okay, so this is a word that I think everybody is aware of. Everybody, I mean, forget financial industry. I think all industries are talking about digital. Okay, so even our vegetable vendor has gone digital now. Okay, so he will say that you can book my vegetables on the this thing mobile app. You know, we will deliver it at home. So the entire, I guess all sectors are talking about digital, and definitely financial services also. So what I've realized is that, and I think that's a good thing for financial inclusion, because now earlier it was always that, you know, we had to go, I mean, the banks had to go and open up branches, you know, in all of these places. So there had to be a physical point of contact to be able to get the unbanked into the into opening accounts. But that is no longer required. I mean, you know, now we can actually open an account online, and you know, almost all the banks have these kind of facilities. Okay, we talk about eKYCs and, you know, so many things that are happening online. Okay, so the way I would like to summarize is that, so financial inclusion already, like Dr. Kshitij spoke about, it is about the unbanked sector. So, you know, so there is the banking part of it, you know, providing deposits, I mean, taking deposits, giving loans, etc., to be able to do that online. So that's the so-called digital services on the banking side, okay, which also includes the fee-based services like, you know, debit cards and credit cards, etc. So here, you mentioned, sir, you know, this Jan Dhan Yojana. So what is so interesting is that, one, like you said, that, you know, it has really grown over the last 5 years in terms of number of accounts being opened. Okay, one another interesting thing that has happened technologically is that, you know, this account has been linked with Aadhaar card, okay, and with mobile number. And this has been used in the last 1 year to actually transfer, you know, all the subsidies that the government wanted to do, okay, directly to the, you know, the impoverished people. Okay, so which used to, there used to be a huge amount of leakage that used to happen, you know, because it will pass through physical channels, etc. That has been completely cut down. So it's been a real win-win because, you know, one, the people who are eligible, they have been getting the money directly into their Jantan account. Okay, and the second thing is that, you know, there is no leakage and, you know, the, whatever government funds are there or taxpayers' money has actually gone to the right people. And this has been made possible by National Payments Corporation. You know, in fact, they are doing wonderful job in terms of this entire payment technology and so many things that are there. And they had actually, they have set up this digital pipeline. And so it's called JAM, you know, even the, you know, in Narendra Modi's era, the what do you call it? Acronyms are also very interesting. So this is called JAM. So Jan Dhan, mobile and, you know, Aadhaar card, something like that. So that's what it is called. And it's made huge wonders. So banking that way has really taken off. That's one area. The second area is insurance. Okay. So insurance services are also something. So like Jan Dhan, there are also, it's called, I think, some Jeevan Suraksha. And there are a couple of schemes like that, which government has launched. Okay, to provide very affordable life and general insurance to the people. When I looked at the numbers, I realized that, you know, they have not really picked up so much. Okay, and I think part of the reason could be that if we compare, let's say, digitalization in banking versus that in insurance, I think insurance is still somewhere behind, you know. So there are strides being taken in insurance. So for example, last year, I personally took my entire life insurance. I wanted to take a new policy. I did that entire process online, okay, with HDFC Life, which would not have been possible, let's say, 3-4 years before. You know, we had to go to a branch or we needed to have an agent, you know, who would come home, fill up forms, etc. But now even insurance is happening. You know, a lot of facilities are available online to be able to, let's say, buy a life insurance policy or even book general insurance policies. Okay, in fact, there are companies. So there is a company called Go Digit, okay, which is actually riding on technology. It's a general insurance company, okay, and it is actually, its differentiator is technology. So their first option to buy policies is online and not an agent. Okay, so they are actually differentiating, and what they are saying is that they are bringing down the cost, okay, because they don't have to open so many branches, etc. So to that extent, we are seeing the digital strides happening even in insurance. Okay, the third area, of course, is payments, okay, where we have seen huge amount of growth because of, you know, UPI is something that has become so popular in the last one or two years. You know, all of us have a Google Pay or a Beam UPI. Okay, all the merchants have the QR codes put up there. Okay, I think probably pandemic has again led to a huge spiral in this thing. But today people are very comfortable. And if you're having that, you know, a UPI account, automatically at the back end, you need to have a bank account. So automatically, you know, you are coming into the financial inclusion part of it. So a chaiwala, you know, who wouldn't have opened an account, you know, would have managed it in cash, today he has opened an account. So I think that way things have really, in a different light, the pandemic plus digital, the technology is available, okay, and financial services wanting to, you know, play on that, ride on that, these have come together very nicely in the last 1 year. So I would just like to summarize saying that, you know, I believe as of today, technologically, I think a lot of solutions are available, a lot of tools are available. Now, it is basically up to the financial services provider, okay, and let's say the government. So the way we saw examples of Jan Dhan Yojana latching onto NPCI platform, or, you know, so there we need to really, you know, work closely, try to look up these technology solutions and provide these services to the unbanked area. So I think that is the way it is right now. I mean, capabilities are there. We need to now ride on that as different stakeholders in this entire process.
I think that's a very genuine point, because you said that you have everything now, the entire platform is ready, technological solutions are there, but now we people has to utilize this in a proper way. Government policies, government has to influence that, private initiative has to be there, and the funding for such projects has to be there. Now, taking a clue from there, I would like to come to Mr. Ganesh Kumar. As Krishna talks about technology, and he said that he talked about banking, he talked about insurance, he talked about payment, and we are talking about huge population of India, and India is a different ballgame or model compared to, in fact, I can't compare India with South Africa or Mauritius or let's say country or any other country. India is a different ballgame because of a huge population, huge potential. That's why it is also there. So do you think from that perspective that India has the entire digital infrastructure to sustain this? What is your view on that?
Good afternoon, everyone. Now, with respect to the digital infrastructure, I think it's going to take some time. But then we see that, like being an academic, I can clearly see that there are students or like, you know, graduates who just clear, who are interested a lot in coming up with startups and getting into a line which is more towards data science or, you know, having artificial intelligence based solutions. Okay. There is also a lot of research being done. So being an economic student, one realizes that you use statistical methods or econometric methods in order to study any kind of a causality when you are studying macroeconomic variables, in the sense that has say financial inclusion really picked up because of technology, whether there is a direct impact or direct causality between, like, you know, has technology caused financial inclusion? Okay, so these kinds of questions are studied a lot as far as, say, institutions are concerned. Nowadays, what has happened is, besides the traditional econometric methods which are available for, say, the researcher, you have a lot of data which is available for you. And because of the presence of so much of data and the availability of data, what has happened is, you know, students who are pursuing, say, their postgraduate research or even their PhD research, they are applying a lot of this AI solutions or, you know, machine learning solutions to this. To give you an example regarding, say, an artificial intelligence solution, there is this group called Vadwani. Vadwani, they have, it's a non-profit organization which is operating basically in Andhra Pradesh. Basically, the region is the Rangareddy district. Okay, so there, over there, what had happened was, because of the influx of pests, okay, the farmers' cotton crop, the cotton farmers, were facing a huge loss. Okay, now this particular non-profit group, what they did was, they came out with an AI-based tool. Now this basic tool can be used in a smartphone, and with the smartphone you can identify the kind of the pests, the rate at which they grow, and what are the possible solutions. Okay, so this particular thing was, like, you know, this the Vadwani group basically in combination with the Telangana government, okay, brought out the solution for this problem of pests using AI solutions. So now you have around 17,000 farmers in the region of the Rangareddy district in Telangana, who basically at least 70% of the farmers have smartphones. Okay, 70% of the farmers have smartphones. They can basically, you know, what is the pest, what exactly is the problem. They can get immediate consultancy as to what is the solution for, or how to basically cut out the loss with respect to the crops. And now this, so Telangana has been like a front runner, and now three other states have basically joined with the Vadwani group in Maharashtra, Gujarat, okay, in Maharashtra, Gujarat and Madhya Pradesh, to, like, such that the same AI based solution, which is basically a smartphone which tells you what is the kind of the pest, how is it going to multiply, how to take care of it, and so on. Okay, so given this simple example, okay, simple example of, say, how to protect your crops, so artificial AI in AI based solution have played a major role, as far as is going to play a major role with respect to, say, agriculture. Now the Vadwani group is also after finding the solutions as to, like, what exactly is the process, why do, like, you know, especially the answer to the question of why do why is there such a rise as far as the farmer suicides are concerned. So they were basically on en route to checking out that question, wherein when they found out that pest was one of the reasons, and this is one solution which you can find in this particular area. Okay, and there is a lot of research being done using machine learning algorithms in order to study various causalities in this particular area of financial corruption, financial inclusion. That's what I would like to say.
I think that's quite beneficial for all the students who's listening or attending this session from ISB or any other part of the world. I think that definitely, if they want more research to be done, they can contact you, and you can help them on that, because since you are following this research so rigorously, that's really nice. But I would like to, before I go to Arun for my questions, I would like 1 minute from Krishna, if he can respond to that, about my question is about how is the digital infrastructure ready in India? Do you think there's a lot of stress there because of 2020 issues? Can you respond to that question quickly, and then we go to Arun?
So according to me, I think India is pretty much leading. This is my perspective, that India is pretty much leading in terms of the kind of payments infrastructure that we have put in place. So like I spoke about, National Payment Corporations of India, not many of us may have heard about it, but when we know the services. So for example, we know UPI. Okay, we know IMPS, day in and day out, we make internet banking payments through that. Okay, we know ATM switches. Okay, and I spoke about this digital pipeline. All of these are technology initiatives of NPCI. Okay, NPCI, which was an initiative of RBI, okay, to be able to set up the entire, payment infrastructure in India. Of course, one more thing I missed out is RuPay. Okay, RuPay cards that are there. Okay. This entire
Sorry to interrupt, Krishna. Yeah. Sorry to interrupt. My intention of asking that is that India is definitely leading on that in terms of products and this. So it's something like that. There are many cars on the road. Is the road big enough? Is the road broad enough?
Go ahead, Ganesh. Yeah.
Yeah. So is it broad enough to accommodate everyone? That is what is hinting at.
In fact, if we look up recently, RBI is actually coming out with initiative saying that there should be one more NPCI. In fact, they are saying that the digital infrastructure, whatever digitalization that we want to do, maybe NPCI cannot handle that kind of a volume. So there is actually a bidding process going on. It's called NUE, okay, where there are other players who are trying to come together, form a collaboration and set up a parallel maybe payment infrastructure. So to that extent, I believe, and today, for example, internet is cheap. We have got data which is there. So we have all those digital, the basic, let's say, from a, from the telecom perspective, I think infrastructure is pretty well laid out. So my perspective is definitely we are there in India in terms of the basic, technology layering capabilities to be able to, work on that. So yes, infrastructure is there, 100%.
I think that's a brilliant point. I'll come back to you again on that in the second round after, if we have some more time, because I have some more questions on that. But, and there's also a question which is already there on our chat box. Somebody has asked this, we'll come to that question after some time. But definitely, as Krishna rightly said, many people don't know about these products. They are already there, but many people don't know about this product. So there's one question always comes about the awareness of the product and technical know-how of the product, how to use that product. There are a lot of psychological factors people still having, that whether I should use this product, or whether my money will be safe, whether my data will be safe. So there are a lot of psychological impact comes there. I have experienced in my own family where I've seen many people are absolutely literate, but still don't want to use some technology platform to transfer the fund and so on and so forth. So from that perspective, Arun, you are a corporate coach, you are a trainer, and you're doing such work in a various segment in various places in India. So can you share your thought on that how awareness can be developed, and how, what is your actual understanding from the grassroots level?
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you, Chiragra, and thank you, ISB and Bharat Institute. This is a very certain points. I thought when Krishna Kumar was speaking, I thought all my points will be taken away from me now. In some time. So somehow he left some points so I can talk some more. Okay, so in that context, this is a I have been, as a part of my social responsibility, I have been undertaking certain trainings in various parts of India, and thanks to the great COVID-19 crisis, I have been now continuing to do on the online platforms. Rather, yesterday itself, I finished with 2 days continuously with people in Haryana. Now, first of all, let me just spell out some basic fears what people have in mind as I talk to them, whether offline or online. Whether my money will be safe, whether my money is going to the right place, I mean the right person, and whether if anything happens, whom should I go to? So these are the three basic questions, apart from certain other questions, three basic questions, very pertinent questions, which come up every now and then as I speak to these people in rural areas or the semi-urban areas. Now, in that case, as I see that how tech is helping these financial inclusion initiatives, and so to say, the transactions. As Krishna Kumar has already pointed out, NPCI is really doing a good work in that area. And to answer that question, maybe that infrastructure maybe is not really good enough, that RBI is now start, or maybe they want another competitor in the place so that they can bring better services. So RBI is looking out for one more NPCI, like one more or two more NPCI, like authorities. So, but as of now, NPCI is really doing a good work. They are training people with the help of the CSR activities of companies like Crisil Foundation or L&T Finance companies. Their CSR activities, they are training people in various parts of India with the help of the kind of the infrastructure that they already have, systems that they have. One is UPI based system, where Bheem, the Bharat interface for money. Then there is another UPI based system like Star 99 Hash. The best part of these two UPI based systems, one works on smartphones, which now almost all of us have, many of us have. In some rural areas, there are some people who do not have smartphones, no access to smartphones. They have the UPI based system called Star 99 Hash, which is called USSD. This system can be used as UPI-based system in the bar phones or feature phones as well. So they are covering almost every person. Now, another point remains to be answered is that whether everyone is willing to do it. Not really. Simply because the one important aspect, whether my money is safe. Because I don't see my money physically, and I don't understand whether it will go to the right person. Though the answers are there in the Bheem app itself, that you get immediate transaction slip as soon as you do any transaction. So that's the best part of it. The best part that has happened over the period of time, as I see it, as I train people on these apps, that Bheem app can be used for multiple of services, like sending money, receiving money, asking for money from someone, then giving, providing gift during the COVID 19 days. Now we are not able to visit to people. They are able to give people gifts with the help of, in the form of money, through Bheem app. Then you can apply for your insurance policy, you can pay back your loans, you can pay bills online. So these are some of the very important services that are coming in through with the help of Bheem. So technology is really, really helping a lot of people, not only in urban areas, also in semi-urban as well as the rural areas. Having said that, I have seen people in urban areas also, they are not really willing to adapt to this, simply because, as I said, we have seen because of the mindset and the fears that they have in mind. Another point which is very important that comes from the NPCI is the services under the name of AEPS, that is Aadhaar Enabled Payment System, which is really a service which goes to the interiors of the villages, any unbanked area. Your bank mitra or the banking correspondent can visit to that particular place and help people carry out certain basic transactions like giving and receiving money or certain other transactions, checking the balance. So these are the things. Now, as I see this, over the period of time, one point that comes to my mind is a lot of people face the problem of connectivity, mobile connection, proper network, and the data. If these three things they are able to solve over the period of time, maybe 1 year or 2 years or 3 years down the line, and maybe covering the entire gamut of rural areas, I think urban and semi-urban are really, really covered quite a few bit of it. If they are able to cover with the help of mobile connectivity, services in the network and data, I think we will be able to have the breakthrough of the financial inclusion that we are looking for. And obviously, as you rightly pointed out in the beginning, Chiragra, that the investments, I think maybe huge investments will be required to do this. Maybe government hand in hand, they have to work with all these things. And I have one last point to make. Maybe we require a structured training and awareness initiatives in a big way, and which is not only in rural areas, in urban areas as well, because I've seen, as I said, in urban areas also, there are people who are still not aware of certain things. If we follow some basic model like ABCD, ask the people what they are really looking for as far as their financial well-being is concerned, brief them, because people do not have enough time to go through their 1 or 2 or 3 hour lectures. So brief them, consult them, see for consult for what they are actually looking for, and actually deliver it. D for delivery. If we could follow this simple model of ABCD, I think maybe it will help in some way going achieving the financial inclusion part. Thank you so much.
Okay. I think that's lovely. ABCD, everybody will remember that. That's a very innovative way, like what Krishna said about JAM. You talked about ABCD. Now is the year, this is the year of abbreviation. That's great. So that's lovely. And you have touched the right pulse, which I was trying to hint and ask Ganesh and Krishna about the data and connectivity and the network part, because I've seen in the rural areas, we don't get network. So that's what I was talking about when you talk about the infrastructure for digitalization, because it's one area, because that makes India quite different, and huge amount of investment is required. So quickly, we are running out of time. We have 5 more minutes and then we'll go to the question and answer session. But I have 2 questions here. One for Kshitij, that as we talked about this huge infrastructure which is required, so how do you think as an analyst, will you analyze that, how India will get such type of funding for such type of big projects, which can take you to the rural areas with connecting network, data management, data warehouse, and everything, which is a big money required. So from your perspective, how do you see that thing happening? And I'll make the second question also so that I don't waste time. We have seen that huge amount of hacking is happening. We have seen that even central banks are not left. We have seen product like SWIFT also gets hacked. So a huge amount of risk is there. So that question is for Krishna and Ganesh Kumar. How we can take care of the cybersecurity? So these are the 2 questions. Quickly, if you panelists can respond.
See, here when we're talking about, there's too much of dependent on the banking system. Okay, when we're looking at infrastructure spending or any kind of very high capital intensive businesses, is hardly you'll find any equity. Okay, you have a high savings rate. But in the banking system, when the bond market, the GSEC market has not yet developed, where in the world the banks are supposed to do to the SLR so much of investments. Currently, almost more than 30% of the bank deposits, net demand and time liabilities, are in the government securities because of lack of investment opportunities in the corporate sector, and obviously of a higher NPA levels. You know, you see the credit growth has been only 6%. There were capital adequacy issues. The public sector banks, smaller ones, had a major problem in terms of, and their money was stuck. So here, if you look at the state electricity boards, for example, you know, it's sort of a moral suasion where the government asked them to, a consortium of banks were funding all these things. The money is stuck, then the banks have to be recapitalized by the government. So the main, even today, despite the increase in private sector share, you see the government banks or the state-owned banks have a large, you know, large role to play. And with the policy where it is too much, even the ex SBI chairman in one of the meetings, she mentioned, there's too much of dependence on debt capital, you know. And debt capital, but not only in debt, but from the banking system. So that is what is happening, is that because of the high deficit and other issues in terms of higher NPAs, low capital, the banks are not funding very high capital intensive business, but they are funding a lot of retail products, you know, home loans and other kind of things, and with a low, you know, maturity. And that is the reason why it has to be that we have to find a way with other multilateral organizations, how this kind of infrastructure, digitalization, you know, the involvement of state governments and central government, that how you take it to the next level for this huge infrastructure which is required. That is what, you know, that is what it comes to my mind currently, because it's a structural problem right now. And that needs to be addressed.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, we will we'll keep on having this for a long time. Yeah.
Precisely. Yeah. I think you have touched the right pulse. Absolutely. Now, let me come to Krishna and Ganesh quickly on the cybersecurity, because we are running out of time. Yes, Krishna, your view on that.
Okay. So, in terms of cybersecurity, yes, there is a problem. I mean, we all are aware of the kind of cyber crimes that keep increasing. So that's a fall. I mean, that's a flip side of going digital in banking services. The way I see it is that, you know, the hackers are intelligent. Okay. The guys who are trying to solve the problem are also intelligent. So the way I see it is, I think it's an ongoing process. So for example, when we started internet banking, quick example, we just had a login and a password. Okay. And then that was decent enough for us to log in and, you know, use the services. Then somebody figured out that, you know, passwords are not strong enough, and they started hacking. Then came CAPTCHA. Okay. So apart from the password, so you just need to enter that CAPTCHA or whatever. Okay. Then that was also, I mean, there were bots which were trying to break that also. And then came two-factor this thing. So OTPs became so prevalent. So today all of us know OTP, right? So that was a solution. So we call it multi-factor authentication from a technical perspective. So OTPs came up, or they will ask you some personal questions. Okay. Name, you know, name of the school that you went to, or, you know, the name of your first vehicle that you own, things like that, which only you may be aware of. And typically these OTPs or whatever come onto the registered mobile, so that the guy who is actually trying to hack in will not maybe have your mobile. But at the same time, you know, alongside that, the other guy on the other side is also thinking more. So the way I see it is that it's going to be a constant process of evolution where, you know, we keep solving the problem. Sometimes we try to be one step, two step ahead of the hackers. Sometimes, you know, we are behind that. Once the problem happens, the next time we have to quickly solve it. I mean, that's the way I see it. It's ongoing in terms of finding solutions. Yeah, Ganesh, your take on it.
Sure. I have nothing more to add.
You don't have nothing. But Ganesh, one thing I just would like to ask you, because as Krishna has rightly said, this is a dynamic process. It is not a static process, because as the police is chasing the thief, and thief is also equally intelligent, so both are running fast. So do you think from a cybersecurity perspective, we should do long-term research, find out some products which can really, you know, think beyond the, or think beyond the thieves, what they're trying to think, you can think before that, or utilize those thieves for doing the research or something like that, where you use the, what do you call that, Krishna?
Let a thief to catch a thief.
No, no, what hacker they are called?
Ethical hacker.
Right, I was not getting the ethical hacker. So do you think such long-term research should be there for that type of work? Quickly, your point on that?
No, research, I wouldn't know. But then since cybersecurity is an economic crime, so there are definitely measures taken by banks and as well as financial institutions and governments, wherein they would want to, you know, they would want to strengthen cybersecurity. And there is like, you know, so there is like a proposal which is always put up by policymakers saying that, you know, we need to strengthen this. But then when it comes to a comparison between like, you know, so a cyber, if you are going to strengthen your cybersecurity, okay, it is going to be a non-developmental expenditure in the sense that, well, you don't know when you're going to, because you don't know when the next crime is going to take place. Okay. Whereas now, when there are policymakers wherein there is a certain group which is vouching for more stringent measures, and there are others who are saying that, you know, probably a dam project or an electricity project or something which is definitely you're going to see the tangibles. So in that particular thing, it will basically depend upon the dominance of the party and how, or the dominance of the policymakers, and which is the project which is going to get favored. So that would be the thing with respect to
exactly
case of paramount importance.
Okay. Sorry, I have to stop you there because we have two questions and we have just three more minutes to go. Then we have to stop it, I suppose. So I would like to take the second question first, which is written on that. I can read it here. And I think this question, I'll leave it to Arun to start with, and other people can join to answer if you have more points on it. The question is,
I saw the question.
Lovely. Are there any psychological impacts noticed because of finance becoming more digital and less physical?
So, since
you are a coach and you talk about psychology, take it quickly.
Okay. Now the point comes here is, because of this digitalization, the people who are willing, I have been talking to hundreds, rather thousands of people, but people who are really willing and they are able to understand the technology and how to make use of the technology, they are the people, they are really happy about it, going for the technology, and they're really making use of it. And as opposed to that, the people who are afraid of the fear that they have in mind, even if you train them, there are people who are still averse to take certain steps in it. Yet I have seen, if you continued efforts of training and awareness, we are able to break through to some extent the people who are yet not willing. They're still able to go for this digitalization, or maybe these we can say the technology based, you know, the finance financial transactions. That has really happened over the period of time.
But do you think it also lead to people's fear that it's becoming more digitalization, so it will lose job in financial sector? Sitesh, your point on that? It's also a psychological factor.
No, here the issue is not, obviously the cost, it is happening in the banking. You know, if you see in the last 2 years, the number of ATMs have also come down, the cost rationalization front. Employees, you know, the hiring, what it used to be in the mid 2000 is not happening, you know. Say ICICI Bank or Axis Bank and all that, you know, they are going very, very slow in terms of, but you know how much, you know, these are basically services, you know, like you don't have to go to a branch. It will be more of a branch rationalization, you know, like earlier you may be opening 200 to 300 branches, but you will not open now. Now the RBI says that you have to open a certain amount of branches in semi-urban and rural areas also, you know, so that they have to, balance that aspect of it. The most important on the psychological part is the fear of data theft. You know, people think that my data, what if I share banking data, whatever, you know, like you'll start getting calls or something, you know, there's a breach. It's happening in a lot of public sector banks that you get calls on that, what is your number, you know, someone is going to deposit so much in your account, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
So it is unsolicited calls. They are selling all kinds of products. The data, your mobile number, your Aadhaar card, and everything is being you know, distributed all over the place. So people are crazy about these things. I feel that is what.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Sitesh. Krishna, your take on the first question, if you have quickly anything, what might be the impact of financial inclusion driven by technology on financial risk? So basically, we're talking from market risk or credit risk perspective. So I think I have something to add, but do you want to take it up?
No, I think Chiragre, you can take it. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I think to answer that question, definitely we have a lot of advantage on this because we have been seeing that if we use a lot of data and we are using machine learning and artificial intelligence for all this thing to predict credit default very nicely. We are using a lot of non-structured data from a data lake perspective, which are all helping, you know, to reduce financial risk perspective. The usage of technology definitely have a negative correlation on financial risk. It is more from a technological risk we are discussing, but use of technology definitely, like machine learning, deep learning, data lake concept, and all this thing definitely help us to predict our credit default or even to predict market much more efficiently than what we used to do earlier. So from that perspective, definitely financial risk can be hedged more efficiently if you use technology. So I see Arushi Jain is here. So that's it. That means we have to close down. Very interesting panel discussion. Thank you everyone for lovely feedback. Thank you so much. I leave it
Thank
with you
so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Chiragra, for such an interesting discussion. Very imperative topic, as I you know, said earlier. And thank you so much, panelists, Mr. Arun, Mr. Kshitij, Mr. Thank Ganesh, you. And Mr. Krishan Kumar for being here. Mr. you want to say something?
Just to add to Chirag's financial risk, see the standstill by the Supreme Court on NPA recognition. So what happened was a bank, because of their own system, and that was all driven by analytics, data science, that they declared pro forma NPA, which means that the asset quality of a lot of banks, you know, had deteriorated, but because of the Supreme Court order, they had not factored in. So banks using data analytics had calculated their own their NPA based on income recognition, asset classification, and based on that, they had made provisions. So what I'm trying to highlight here is that going forward, when the December, March quarter numbers will come out, the banks have already put a lot of money in terms of provision for the asset quality, which may deteriorate. And that they have used a lot of data science and internal assessment models. Most banks have done that. That is what I wanted to add.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for a wonderful discussion. Thanks, everyone.